can you tell me a little bit about the history of CASA, SASA, yep. the Canadian Canada Accredited Zoos and Aquarium? What is your goal fundamentally as an organization?
We want to be the tide that raises all boats, essentially. And the meat and potatoes of what we do is our accreditation system. We have an accreditation standards that have been developed over the course of 40 years here in Canada. And we have a process by which we go about accrediting facilities. We have 28 members across Canada that are accredited. It is a peer review based system that measures outcomes. And it is a standard of care, standard of animal welfare that looks at education, looks at conservation efforts, looks at your overall operations. It's not one that's easily met. However, it does really place the standard above all else across Canada.
I mean, you touched on it there, but just to expand a little bit more, why is it so important, in your opinion, to have this accreditation as an organization?
Because we really are looking out for the welfare of the animals that are in the care of humans across Canada. We want to really educate the public about what it is that we, not only what CASA does, but what it is to be a conservationist, what it is to take care of animals that are in the care of humans across Canada, and really get them to understand and connect with nature. You know, we all live very busy lives, and many people don't have the opportunity to get out and to really connect. And this is going to an accredited facility across Canada is one way that we hope Canadians will.
And one of said accredited facilities is one we're stood in right now. We're at Little Rays Nature Center because they have recently won one of the many coveted awards that your organization does hand out. Could you explain a little bit some of the elements you're looking for in your award winners? And can you just give us a little insight perhaps as to why Little Rays ended up into the categories?
I can't go into detail about why Little Rays versus another applicant, but I can say that you know, the applicants are really proud of what they do, and all of them have done an exceptional job, whether it's building new habitats, bringing in new animal care practices, really focusing on educational programs, especially during this pandemic. It has been especially hard to do all of those things and meet all of the missions and the visions that our members have. Our awards are shine a light on the exemplary work that our members do, and they're all fantastic. And I don't envy the judges in what they had to do to rate them all, especially during this pandemic. But Little Ray Nature Centers has proven over the years in its category of a smaller facility to be one that others can look to as an example going forward.
And you may not be able to touch on why Little Ray is above something else, but one of the things I wanted to ask, you have many different categories named after many different people and many other organizations. This one in particular is named after Peter Carson. It's the Peter Carson Award. I did a little bit of diving into it myself. I know you're originally from Germany. Could you talk to us a little bit about the significance of this award and why you chose to name it after him?
Well, I don't know about the history in terms of exactly why the name, but these are obviously people that have stood out over the years in this industry. And you know, this award, like all of them, is really something that makes the winners and even the nominees are supposed to put their name forward stand out. It's a very difficult one to judge. It takes some time and there's criteria that they have to meet, but the judging is all done in private. So it's no one knows who's actually judging and the judges don't know who else is judging.
One of the fantastic elements of it, that anonymity and complete lack of bias in terms of votes. Since I have you today, it'd be crazy to not ask. Zoos, aquariums, and other establishments that keep animals in captivity have come over some controversy in general over the last couple of decades as we rethink the ethical dilemma that surrounds captivity a little bit. Do you think these kind of facilities still have a place in the world? And how do some of them, especially those accredited, for example, take their place in that kind of world?
I can only speak for accredited facilities of 28 across Canada, and the short answer is yes. And it really is about education. Educating our visitors, 12 million a year, generally speaking, about what it is to maintain species, about species around the world. Now, we have members like Little Rays, like Calgary, like Toronto, like Park Safari in Hemingford, that work with facilities and other organizations around the world to maintain their facilities and contribute to that. You know, most recently we have Park Safari. There are two cheetahs in Zimbabwe that were born in Canada. or are now living in a semi-wild environment in Zimbabwe. That took a long time to get done. So these are projects and examples of species conservation that our members are involved in all the time. So the role that an accredited zoo and aquarium plays in society today is one of educating people about those programs, about what they do, and about animals in more broadly speaking.
And you mentioned that you have 28 accredited facilities around the country. The pandemic has been very hard on many of them. We've spoke to Little Rays back in February this year when they were doing a mammoth bottle drive to even try and raise money to make sure that none of these animals were left without a place to go. As many of them, this was their last resort because a lot of them were exotic animals that were seized illegally, and Little Rays has given them a new home. Looking broadly across the country, these kind of issues you saw in your other facilities as well, and how are they coming as we're finally seeing a light at the end of this tunnel?
Yeah, we are finally seeing a light at the end of this tunnel, and yes, we have seen this right across Canada. You know, we were just talking earlier, one of the differentiating factors that exists in an accredited facility is the fixed costs, the overhead, the care of that being the care of the animals. That does not change for any facility across Canada. They must maintain the health care of the animals, the welfare of the animals, bar none, no matter what. And for many, it was very difficult. But one thing I can tell you, and I have visited 20 of our 28 members thus far and talked to many of them, is that the people who care for these animals each and every day are the most committed, caring people you'll ever meet in your life. And many of them were prepared to stay overnight at the very early days of the pandemic because they just did not want to leave their animals. They're very, very concerned. At that time, you go back to March, April, May of 2020, there was a lot we did not know as a society, and we began to know more. So the pandemic hit our memberships in each region differently. Many people don't understand that on the tourism side and the travel side, that there's about on average between 25 and 30% of the visitors that visit an accredited facility across Canada are in fact international visitors, whether they come from the United States or elsewhere in the world. Those visitors aren't happening. So those revenues get used for animal welfare programs, for education and whatnot. So it's been very difficult. We actually lost a facility in New Brunswick, Cherrybrook. We lost Cherrybrook Zoo in St. John, New Brunswick. It was the first thing I had to do was help shut it down, tragically. But others have survived, come out of it. But it's been very difficult. A lot of them that are privately held have had to assume an increased amount of debt, and that will be with them for some time to come. Others have had to lay off a lot of staff, unfortunately. So they're no different in many respects than any other small business across Canada in that regard.
And what is the way forward really from here? Is it more governmental support? Is it just time and getting open again? Where do you see us going from here?
I think going forward from here, it really is about time, opening up the economy, getting travelers back into Canada, getting people moving again within Canada, and getting people back to visiting accredited facilities. Because as one member mentioned to me when he was locked down for an extended period of time because of where he is located, he said, Jim, we just want to open. And they just want to open. And that's really, at the end of the day, the goal and the objective is that our facilities want to be open. We've done it safely. We know we can do it. We've done it now for essentially two seasons, if you will. And we can do it going forward. So getting the economy going again, getting travel and tourism up and running again, the way it has before 2019, I think is the way forward.
And finally, whether you have the president hat on or off with this question is up to you. Prior, whilst I was setting up, you're walking around this facility, you're looking at, what do you make of it here? What do you make of the facility we've got in place?
You know, again, Lee and I were just talking about that. Is the first impression, is it clean facilities? I think when you go to an accredited facility, that's the first impression you're going to get, is the attention to detail, the cleanliness, and the care of the animals. And you walked in here today and you saw staff right off the bat, first thing is taking care of the animals, making sure they're fed, changing their food, that kind of thing. It's going on as we speak. And that is the first impression that I had. And it's the first impression that I've had going right across Canada. And to see it, you see the difference that accreditation makes. It's a way of thinking, it's a way of not just doing business, but it's a culture and attention to detail. We're quite proud of them.
So first of all, could you just tell me a little bit about yourself and the work you do here at Little Rays?
Sure. Yeah, I'm the as the zoo director, I kind of wear many hats, and it's always been a very, very fun job for me, or career for me, path that I've taken, just because of the reason that we our day-to-day changes so much. I do animal care, I do oversight of the staff, I do training of staff, I make sure all the policies and procedures are followed, I make sure we meet the standards that CASA are required to meet, and it's just getting out there to talk to public and putting my passion across the public to help educate and teach people about the importance of facilities like this, why we exist, what we do, and giving the opportunity for somebody to meet an animal and go home with that hands-on connection, because that's what we need to try and continue this direction forward, where we're trying to do conservation. And it's not just here, it's worldwide.
Yeah, conservation and education is something CASA definitely emphasized, and I know is a big part of your role here. Obviously, we're here down to speak to you guys because you are the recipients of the Peter Karsten Award in this year's CASA Awards. First of all, just simply on an emotional feeling right now, how does it feel to not only be recognized for the work you've done, but actually get an award that really symbolizes the work that you and the team put in?
It's always super emotional. I mean, and it filters down from the top. So the moment we hear that the award came in, you can see the emotion from Little Ray's side. You get the emotion across all the staff that are here, because the passion that everyone that is here, that's what we're here for. We're here to drive and strive to get that conservation message across on a daily basis. So everyone gets super emotional. It comes through, it gets filtered through, and you just see how everyone excitement ramps up during these periods, and know that we're making that change in what we do.
And you mentioned earlier about the work you do here and being able to really show people what it is you do. The business has been set up since 1995.
That's right.
We've spoken to Paul, to Little Ray beforehand, and one of the main purposes is to rehome and relocate seized exotic animals. In fact, you're actually one of the largest exotic animal sanctuaries in the country.
That's right.
Which comes a little bit ironic considering the Peter Karsten Award was for a small facility. So could you talk to us about like what is this facility to you and just why you're so important?
For sure. So this is where Little Ray started his facility as an awareness driver, education, conservation, and rescuing. Giving these animals a chance where nobody else would really give them a chance. That's where it all strived from. And then from there, his vision grew and became larger. And that's where we got the Peter Karsten Award was for one of our museum exhibits, the Wildlife Rescue. And these are super in-depth, museum exhibits that we set up. And these museum exhibits that go out are just, I mean, everything is there, tons of information. We have the staffing out there to drive this awareness to people, giving them that opportunity to meet and see them. And that's exactly what this does. By getting out to all these different facilities, putting up these smaller satellite museum exhibits, but still getting our same messages across. And that's exactly what we do here. We rescue to try and give every animal a chance before it gets put to a point where it doesn't have to be euthanized. We believe in every animal has that chance.
Yeah, and one of the fears was earlier this year you're going to be pushed that far, which we'll touch on in a second. Looking at this award, obviously it recognizes excellence in animal care and conservation, some of your key priorities here. Anyway, can you talk to us about some of the investments that Little Rays have made into creating the best habitats possible for the animals here? We know earlier this year some of the struggle was the number of different microclimates you have to create for all the different animals you have here. So talk to us about some of those investments.
Yeah, I mean, it's obviously COVID put a massive hole in and dampen on a lot of things. As soon as we got into this location and this build, COVID hit. And it really put a big dampen on everything. And we got stuff going, and we did the best what we could at that time. And we fought through, we had a lot of public help coming in, we had reaching out, people were coming in. It was a fight to try and get that same funding through governments, or through the government to help us through, because we're a different organization. We're not a bookstore, we're not a coffee shop or something like that. We're completely different. And animals are one of those things that have, you need to be there, you need to care for them, you need to look after them. And Little Ray's done so much hard work, and his wife Sherry, and the rest of the team have all worked so hard throughout this process to maintain and sustain the construction of these habitats and to get the habitats to where they are right now. And now, as we slowly coming out of this to a degree, we're starting to improve and continue that growth, which is super important for us.
Absolutely, and you mentioned the pandemic there, and I said, like, we last spoke here back in February. when you were completing a mammoth bottle drive to be able to supplement some of the government funding you just mentioned in order to, quote Paul and quote yourself from earlier, pay the bills and literally save these animals' 100%. Lives who had nowhere else to go. So how have the last 8 months been?
It's definitely, you see that light at the end of the tunnel. And I remember talking to little Ray about it. I said, during the midst of COVID, it felt like the light at the end of the tunnel we were seeing was actually the train coming back at us. And we weren't actually getting out of it. Whereas now we're starting to see that light at the end of the tunnel, which actually is that light. And people are now getting vaccinated. People are still working together. We're getting out, things are opening up for us where we're able to get museum exhibits out and get money coming in. It might not be everything that we need, but it is coming in, and that's giving us that glimmer of hope that we are in the right direction. We know that COVID's gonna be around for a long time. It's not gonna go away tomorrow. So it's just something we have now had to adapt to and learn to navigate to get through in our facility. And we've had to change our standards and our structures and things, the way that we run the facilities, by following protocols and procedures to make sure that everyone stays safe and from this COVID-19. And that's exactly what we've done. But we're maintaining that, and that's giving us that hope that we're gonna get through this.
And given all the barriers, the trials and tribulations, and all the other hardships that obviously everyone has faced, but you guys have faced it. I know you touched on it in my first question, sure. But how does it feel after all of that to not only be nominated for something, but to win an award by an organization that accredits only some of the, to use a potentially biased word, some of the best facilities in the country?
You know what it is? It's so exciting. And during the whole midst of this COVID-19, when people think you're down and you're the lowest of the low, being part of an organization like Little Rays that does so much rescue and so much, and then having CARES on board and being part of an accredited facility like this, we've done super great things through this. And being part of programs, which is what this award came to us for through Wildlife Rescue, because of people that are out there striving for the same thing that we are. And these individuals out there making a difference. Little Ray got involved years ago in a person that had a collection of animals passed away. And they had a pair of Orinoco crocodiles from Venezuela. And they were told that we would never get them out of Canada. And they said, there's no chance that you're ever gonna get these animals moved. And Little Ray fought and fought and fought. And he managed to get them across the border. And he got them into the US. And the amazing thing through this, even through COVID, these crocodilians have now bred in captivity. They are now, the babies that have been hatched out within the next year have been authorized to be released back into Venezuela, which is one of the rarest crocodiles in the world that is now getting this opportunity to go back. And these are the conservation projects that we're striving for. Little Ray did a ton of work in Myanmar with the star tortoises, Burmese star tortoises, to get that project off the way. And that's funding he's put into these projects, and that's what makes this so worthwhile. And that's what, when we get these awards, just brings in the excitement, brings in the emotion, because that's what we're all striving for.
And as I said, I was here back in February. You guys were putting some finishing touches to the new facility here. You were trying to get yourselves ready for the day and in the future when you could be open. But you open.
We are.
You are taking people in.
Tell us
a little bit about your opening times, and for the listeners out there, why should they come down and check out what you've got going on?
Definitely come down. We've had a lot of support. People have come down. They had great times. You got great reviews online. We've had nothing but 5-star ratings because of the great experience people are having. The staff here are not under the weather, they're upbeat, they're trying to make it through this. And so we're open, we do private tours. You can book a private tour. You get a personal staff member that takes you around the entire facility, talks about the in-depth background of where each of these animals came from, where they were saved from, where they're going to, what's gonna happen to them long term. And people get up close and in front of this, personal, with these animals that some people may never get a chance to see. But here, when you see these little kids walk up and get a chance to touch a turtle or to see a lemur through a window or to meet a sloth, these are memories that they don't only take home, but it's something that's gonna help them remember, we need to help that animal. I got a chance to meet him. What can I do outside of this to continue this conservation education program that's going forward? And that's exactly why we want people to come down. So you can get online, you can go to info@lrnc.ca, book a private tour with us. They're 1.5 hours long, and it's just a great opportunity. We do schedule them spaced out so that there's no cross-contamination for COVID and things like that. We do follow a set pathway through the facility. And it's just, we've had such a positive hit on it that we're probably gonna end up going that way for the future.
Fantastic. And you guys open throughout the winter months as
well? We are. We open pretty much 365 days a year. The only day we close is really Christmas Day. But other than that, we're here. We open Monday through Sunday, and it's from 10 o'clock until, depending what time the tours are booked, right up to 6 or 7 o'clock at night.
Fantastic. Well, thank you very much for taking your time to speak with us today. And congratulations once again on a well-deserved award.
Thank you so much. We appreciate it.